having a chat.
And their tummies are full. They're full. Well, this is great. Like, we get to do another session of having a chat.
Having a chat.
We've talked about a lot of church life things. We've talked about COVID. We've talked about some of the name changing. We've talked about land.
Yep.
We've hit a number of things.
And lots of different things.
We've got a new question in, which is a great question, by the way.
Yep.
And thanks for those of you that are sending in stuff. We appreciate it. Talking about the farmer's market. We've got a farmer's market out front happening after second service here at Saints Church Glastonbury.
Yep.
And yeah, so lots of questions raised. Why a farmer's market? Why Sunday? Have we started selling doves in the courtyard?
Right.
All those things. So yeah, this is seems like a perfect thing to have a chat about.
Absolutely. So those are for you who, again, aren't familiar. My name is Brett. I'm a senior pastor here at Saints Church, joined by our board chair at Saints Church Glastonbury, Peter Izinga. And we're honored to take your questions, talk about all these apparently hot topics awesome. In our community. And what we thought we could do is let's look at some scripture and then let's have a conversation. So if you're wondering, there's this question that has come in around the market, and it's about, hey, so in the scripture, Jesus has gone into the temple and he's flipping tables over and he's mad and he's angry, he's upset. You know, in the account in John 2, he's making a whip and he's cracking the whip, and you know, things are all getting flipped over. So there's these occurrences of Jesus doing this in the temple. You can find it in Matthew 21, you can find it in Mark, and you can also find it in John, though it's not in Luke. So there's different occurrences. I'm going to read Matthew 21. This is starting at verse 12. It says, Jesus entered the temple and began to drive out all the people buying and selling animals for sacrifice. Okay, so that's the first group. Then he knocked over the tables of the money changers and the chairs of those selling doves. Okay, so there's numbers 2 and 3, but they're tied together. And he said to them, the scriptures declare, my temple will be called a house of prayer, but you've turned it into a den of thieves. The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. And the leading priests and teachers of religious law saw these wonderful miracles and heard even the children in the temple shouting, praise God for the Son of David. But the leaders were indignant. They asked Jesus, do you hear what these children are saying? And Jesus says, yes. Haven't you ever read the scriptures? For they say, you have taught children and infants to give you praise. And he returned to Bethany, where he stayed overnight. So I read the whole passage because context is king. And I think the first thing that I notice when I'm reading a passage like that, when I read the entire passage, is that he moved right on. And Jesus was upset about things going on. And then Pharisees were equally upset about something else going on. They're upset about children and children being a part of church, worshiping in church. Is, don't you know this is a place for the proper? And Jesus shares some scripture with them. But he rolls in and he starts driving things out, right? So different categories. The first category is just people buying and selling animals. So when we stroll through, you know, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy in the Old Testament, you will find that the basis of the Jewish faith and what is the Old Covenant for us as believers was based around animal sacrifice. And so sometimes we get really nervous about that because we take our 21st century of ethic and go, you can't harm animals. And we get really upset about that. So Jesus goes in and he goes, listen, I'm going to drive all these people out selling animals for sacrifice. So that's the first group. The second group, and Pete, maybe you can talk about these doves, but he knocked over the tables of the money changers and the chairs of those selling doves.
Yeah, so the doves... So Jesus specifically calls out the dove sellers.
Yep.
I mean, there's people selling lambs,
yep.
Goats, large cattle.
Yep.
I mean, they're selling multiple things there. But in Leviticus, even, it talks about the doves being that for those that are, people were poor, and also for the women.
Mm-hmm.
They were using this. And it's very interesting. As the question came up, and honestly, great question, because it's important for us to ask these things.
Yep.
As I was looking more into some of the commentaries and some of the other leading thoughts on this, the doves were specifically used by those that were poor and those that had lesser money. They were considered, if you can't do this, then this is also something you can do. In looking at that time, the price of doves had tripled beyond what it should be.
Yeah.
These people were being taken advantage of, as well as the people that were coming in, not only from the urban, but also the foreigners. As they travel a long distance, they didn't bring the animals with them.
Right.
They would buy these things there, and they were being charged exorbitant amounts of money. And so there was a big thing that was happening. And this is why, as you said, context is king.
Mm-hmm.
Context is really important to understand the whole story, what was happening at this time. People were being taken advantage of. This had gone from something that was a heartfelt transformational experience into a transaction.
Yep.
And you could do this, pay your money. You were getting ripped off by the money changers.
Yep.
They would, you know, as you changed Roman currency to Hebrew currency,
yep.
you were getting charged an exorbitant amount.
Yep.
Then you were buying these doves. You were also overpaying for the doves.
Yep.
These people were getting money taken from them at every point. And the religious establishment at the time was fully blessing this. They they knew this was happening, and they were getting a cut of all this.
And so not only was it just the practice of how they were selling what they were selling, they're selling a low-grade animal. So in Scripture, you're actually supposed to bring the best of your best, and that's what you bring to honor to the Lord if you go back to the Old Covenant and understand there's actually parameters around the animals. The animals that they were bringing were not of a high grade. They were actually of a low grade because they sold off the rest of the herds for premium profit. But here's where the rubber hits the road. Why were they selling animals? Why were they exchanging money? Why are they selling doves? For the forgiveness of sin. So before Jesus, the only way sin could be forgiven was by blood, by a sacrifice of an animal. So you could not get this. You could not get your sins forgiven unless you paid these exorbitant fees and you were getting ripped off week after week, month after month. And as the culture shifted from a rural agricultural society, the world changed, became more urban. People don't, you know, you can't, you know, it's like, you know, there's urban chickens and things now, you know, but they didn't have these animals because remember, early Old Covenant, when the scripture was written, that was their whole livelihood. You didn't have money. You had livestock and you had animals.
That's how they measured wealth.
Yeah. And so this is also the basis of, and if we go through church history, Martin Luther, the reformation of the church, he got upset because the church of the day, the Catholic church of the day, was selling indulgences. They sold trinkets and items and products that if you bought those things, that your family members or your loved ones who are passed away could get into heaven. Right. And so this began this basis. So what's Jesus doing? He says, listen, you cannot monetize salvation. You can't buy it. There's only one person who's purchased it, and he purchased it with his blood. He was upset that they were turning this into a transaction for salvation.
Yeah.
This is a house of prayer. This is a place for you to come and repent, for you to be forgiven. This is a place of transformation, not a place where you buy your way in. And this system emerged, and the truth is, was the system flawed? Sure, but for a while it worked pretty well.
Yeah, it was a service that was needed.
Yeah, and then it, just like anything else, greed, manipulation, all these things take root. So now let's think about our farmer's market.
Yeah.
Are we selling salvation at the farmer's market? We are not. That's not our purpose. What is the purpose of the farmer's market? Well, we have an incredible community that we're a part of. And we've got great friends, we've got great neighbors, and there are people that are members of our church that live in our neighborhood, and there are people that are far from God. And first things first, we know that we are all in need of community, and if COVID has taught us anything, is that we need people, we need a friend. And for those of us who are isolated, it's maybe difficult to get out and to get around. We have a whole building next door to us of people in assisted living who have no human contact for an extended period of time. And now they can come out, they can walk around, they can see some friendly faces. So we provide a venue and an opportunity for natural and organic community to form.
So bringing it all together, based off of the passages in the New Testament, I mean, looking at the money, there's no exorbitant amounts. There's nobody, we're not trying to take advantage of the poor, the disadvantaged. And it really comes back to what's the point.
Yeah.
And if the point is about building community.
Yep.
And I would equate this, and this is where it's always something that we have to monitor and
yep.
keep our eyes on as a church. What's the point? And make yep. sure that this doesn't become the main focus.
Yep.
That it is simply a tool to help us bring community to this neighborhood, whatever neighborhood we're in.
Absolutely. And what's really cool is on average, we see about 400, 450 people, largely from our community, coming through the farmer's market for that four-hour window from 12:30 to 4:30. So on any given Sunday, 400 people that maybe are not yet ready to step foot into the building are coming, and they're rubbing shoulders and having conversation. You know, if I could encourage anything, I would love to see more of our church family yeah. stick around so that those organic relationships and conversations could develop. Are our hearts open, or is just the building open?
Right.
Are our lives open, or do we have services? And this is now the tension that we're living in, and we try things. We're gonna try this. We're gonna evaluate it at the end of the season and see if it accomplished the purpose of forming new relationships with the community, building community trust. We know that it's already accomplished some of those things.
Right.
We don't make anything from this. In fact, it's a break-even venture at best, because it's not about making money. It's about creating an opportunity for connection and community and relationship inside the church and outside the church, and to hopefully bring those worlds together.
Yeah. So we're going to put this under a bigger context,
right.
A bigger, this is an instance of us as a church community doing something, but there's a bigger umbrella that this falls under. And yeah. what's that bigger umbrella, that bigger purpose?
Yeah. We're trying to build community. We're trying to build community in a couple places. We're trying to build community in our church family. It gives us an opportunity. So when we came up with the idea of the farmers market, it was actually during COVID. And so we were like, what's a COVID-safe way that we could have people gathered together and that they could meet and they could hang out and that we could facilitate a safe venue for community and connection? Primarily, first was for our church family, because we noticed that there's a need for this. And also, and I would say they're parallel, not one or the other, for our community. How can we serve our community in this way?
Yeah. Yeah, and it, I think it's important for us as a church community to realize we have an opportunity quite literally on our doorstep.
Yep.
I have friends, non-saved friends, that live across the street.
Yep.
Quite honestly, they can see our church building from their apartment. And they're like, what's that thing that's going on? And I said, oh, this is what's happening. And they're like, oh, maybe I should check that out.
Yeah.
They've never had the desire to walk across the street
yeah.
prior to this.
Yeah.
And so here's a perfect opportunity for us to meet our neighbors, to start building a community in this community,
yeah.
and start becoming a place where we're known for more than just telling. We're there for living.
Yep. And loving.
And loving.
This is the opportunity to show the love, not only the love we have for one another, which, by the way, is infectious and contagious. It's why it's a marker in John 13:35. It's why Jesus said they will know you by your... We always stop short. We say they'll know you by your love. No, he says they'll know you by your love for one another, that there's this bigger community. He's drawing us in. We are actually yeah. created for community. And the thing that is the antidote to a society that is entirely me-focused and narcissistic is a community and a place that is focused on just that community,
right.
for something that's bigger than ourselves, the body.
So if people want to start having family dinner in the farmer's market, that's a good idea.
It's a great idea. And maybe they're, hey, you know what? Maybe you've got a son or a daughter that's walked away from the faith, and you come here faithfully, and they have no desire to come in the doors just yet. And you're praying for them, and you're faithfully praying for them. I bet you they'd have lunch with you at the farmer's market.
Absolutely.
I bet you that would open up a great conversation about why, about what we stand for, about what we believe in, about how we love not only ourselves, but we love our neighbors, and we're creating safe places for deep and lasting connection to start. Is it the close or is it the finish? No, it's a one step in the process. But hey, what are we called to do? Follow Jesus one step at a time. And yeah. so we're going to try this, and then we're going to evaluate. We'll see how it does, and we might do it again. We might not do it again. Now, there's another question attached to that question is, why Sunday over any other mm-hmm. day? And so there's kind of two angles that we could come at this with. I think the why Sunday is leaning into like a Sabbath idea, like, well, we shouldn't be doing this on a Sunday. And I would just say, well, do you go for lunch somewhere ever on a Sunday? If you do, you're violating the same principle. If that's the principle that you're trying to enact, Sabbath in the new covenant is important, but it's a lifestyle, and more than a day, it's intentionality, and it's an intentionality away from the rigors of work. And, you know, depending on your school of thought, it's still Saturday, depending on, you know, what feels.
You want to get technical on what's the Sabbath.
Yeah.
So I come from a more, my background is a little bit more Orthodox. Yep. So of course, Sunday was a very big deal.
Yep.
And so it depends on how far you want to carry that. Are you allowed to mow your lawn on Sunday?
Yep.
Are you allowed to turn on your stove on Sunday?
Yep.
Are you allowed, if you want to go all that, are you allowed to cause the electricity in your fridge to be turned on? I mean, you can carry this to very detailed levels. But as we go back to what's the purpose, what's the context, as Jesus would tell us that the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath.
Yep.
So let us get back to the purpose and the context of what this is about. This is supposed to be a restful experience. This is supposed to be a time for you to do things a little bit differently, of which this totally fills into that gap.
Mm-hmm.
And this gives us the ability to hang out in a context. I don't normally hang out at farmers markets during the week because I work.
Yep.
This gives me a time to do that and to hang out and meet people and talk about what's going on in their lives.
Yep.
Had some great conversations this morning, standing in line for pancakes.
Yeah, so if we don't have a problem with the pancake breakfast, should we have a problem with the farmers market? And I'm going to say That's up to you. And I'm going to say no, but that's up to you.
And folks, I mean, we understand, like, these are good questions to ask. And
100%.
And saying, by asking the question, you have, no, these are things we always have to examine our faith, examine our spirit, and examine the motive.
Yeah.
And if the motive of this whole thing is about building community, providing places for us to interact with our neighbors in a way that they feel safe, that they feel comfortable, it's a little bit more for the familiar for them.
Yeah.
So a lot of them are used to going to farmers markets.
Definitely.
So this is a safe ground. This is neutral space.
Yeah.
And at the same time, we can have conversations with people of faith and talk about things that are more than just the farmer's market.
And so then one last part of the question is this just a way to support businesses in the church? And the answer is no. It's not a way to support businesses in the church, though I suppose that's a byproduct of it.
Sure.
Not all of our vendors. In fact, most of our vendors, I'm thinking about today specifically, are not from our church. They're from our community. And actually, one of our vendors who's on a food truck comes and chooses to come. He actually has turned down other events to come to ours. And he comes because he saw the way that our church fed people during COVID, took care of people's most basic needs. He saw the church being the church. And he says, you know what? Because you gave back, I want to come and be a part of that. That's why he comes.
Yeah.
That's why he comes and gives you huge scoops of ice cream and other things, you know, because he says, you know, I saw and I want to be a part of it. When I heard that it was the same people and the same thing, you gave back to this community, so we want to give back too.
Yeah.
That's a pretty amazing testimony from somebody who does not yet know Jesus, but I can tell you there's been some great conversations.
And so for those of you that haven't gone to the farmers market, I'd encourage you. Come out. It's a fun time. But as well, it gives you an opportunity as I've bought stuff from our vendors out there and said, hey, thanks for being here. It means a lot to me that you would support us in this and that you'd be here. I know it's another venue but it means a lot for us that you're here as well.
Yep.
And they just appreciate those words of support.
Yeah.
And you never know what those conversations with our vendors might lead to.
Absolutely.
And so we're grateful for them coming out. I'm grateful for Brett and staff having this really innovative idea. I think this is about, as we're going into our next season and we're talking about what church looks like in 2021, we're going to be looking at how can we do church differently, not because we want to be different, but because we want to be continue to be effective in this new season we come into. And as we look at for what are innovative ways for us to continue sharing the gospel in ways that people can resonate with in this day and age, these will be the things we look at.
Yeah, and we're gonna test things, we're gonna try things. In some ways, we're gonna fail forward. Some things will work, some things won't work. You might even have an amazing idea. You might have something that's burning in your heart that, hey, could we give this a try? This is what I think it's gonna do. This is how it's gonna reach our community. You know, I think about Jesus, and it's echoed later by Paul saying, you know, it's about the spirit of the law, not the letter of the law. That's what, you know, we can have a lens in the New Covenant, New Testament to understand that. Long story short, are we violating scripture? No. In fact, I think we're walking it out and living it out by sharing the love of Jesus in a very tangible, community-based way to reach those who are far from him. And 1 Peter says he's actually delaying his return, patiently waiting, it says in 1 Peter, until more could be reached. So I want to invite you. We've only got a few weeks left. We're done on Labor Day weekend. That's our last market. It's been a great window, great season. Come on out. Invite somebody who's far from Jesus to meet you at the market. Then have a conversation about how much you love them and how much Jesus loves them. And I just wonder if God wants to do something in you and through you at this market this Sunday. Thanks for joining us on Having a Chat.